Hello, everyone, and thank you for joining our Wealth Compliance Leaders Series. My guest today is Ryan Smith, and Ryan has a storied career. He's done it all, and he currently helps broker-dealers and RIAs with legal and compliance matters, helping them grow their business and allowing him to focus on legal and compliance matters. Hope you enjoy the conversation. Ryan, thank you for making time. And as always, always nice catching up with you.
Always. Thank you for having me. It's a pleasure to be here.
All right. We met at a compliance conference, and I quickly learned how storied of a career you've had, aside from being a true sports fan. You've worked in a regulatory capacity, you've worked in fintech, and also in private practice. If I'd like to start here because it sort of gives our audience an opportunity to kind of get to know you better. If you were to step back, what led to your interest in our industry anyways? And I guess financial market regulation.
I wish I could attribute it to a grand plan that I came up with in high school, but that would be certainly an exaggeration. So I'll take you back to a time, it was not long after the dinosaurs went extinct. I'm in college and I'm at the University of Maryland and I'm studying architecture of all things. And I realized, though, in the middle of the program, I really didn't want to become an architect. It's a fantastic subject. Fascinating. I just didn't have the chops for it. But I also needed to graduate within 4 years. So I got my degree and pivoted. And when I pivoted, I did like what many kids did at that age. I found a headhunter. And the headhunter placed me at the Investment Company Institute, which is the mutual funds trade organization. And there I was Chandler Bing. Before Chandler Bing, I was the guy running stats, I was collecting data, I was running the database. I mean, the irony was that at the time, I didn't know a mutual fund from a mutual acquaintance. I had no idea what the industry is all about, but it was interesting to me. And so from there, I went to a law firm, still working in the mutual fund business. I was now at that time going to law school at night. Ultimately made my way while I'm still in law school to NEC regulation, where I was an advertising analyst. So the entire time this business made sense to me. It was interesting to me. And I especially appreciated what mutual funds did to the industry because this is the time where the industry is really starting to explode and it made Wall Street accessible to, you know, everyday investors in a very profound way. So from there, after I was admitted to the bar, went to Wachovia Securities, where I was a litigator for them for some time, went back to FINRA, as you noted. I was in-house counsel for FINRA for almost 9 years, held a variety of posts there, including running their private placement review desk. From there, went to Folio Investments, where I was the associate general counsel and chief compliance officer through its acquisition by a large investment bank. And then finally, just last year, I went to private practice, where I help broker-dealers, registered investment advisors, and their associates with a wide range of legal and compliance need, including outsourced CCO and all the way through arbitration services and most issues in between.
I feel like you need a few more points of experience in your career, Ryan. And I love the Friends references. Thank you for sharing that. Why I was looking forward to this conversation was because you've got practical experience and you've seen it on both sides of the fence, right? So you've seen the application of regulation when you spent a good chunk of your career at FINRA. Speaking of regulation, there's been a tremendous sort of, I'll call it waves upon waves of regulations that have really kind of honed in on that whole free trade obligation, right? Making rollover recommendations that are compliant, making product and account type recommendations that are in the investor's best interest. From your career journey, from your, call it even private practice, theoretically and more practically, why do you think there's this magnifying lens on this particular side of the industry or this particular segment of the industry?
Well, obviously, I'll let the staff and the commission speak for themselves on this particular one, but if I take a swing at it, what I've seen from time to time throughout my career, and this applies when I was a litigator for Wachovia to when I was a regulator, even to this day, is that issues arise where there are information asymmetries. Expectations aren't met. Information is not known to one side or the other or to both. And sometimes issues happen. I think what the staff is and the commission are trying to do with respect to Reg BI is address that, to get out into the open, evaluating alternatives or discussing conflicts. Now, whether this will change somebody's view of, I would have made a different decision if I'd known X, Y, or Z, I don't know. We'll time will tell, but certainly I think that's what it's designed to flesh out, and we'll let the industry decide if that's going to affect, you know, the practical effect of Reg BI.
You know, this is a bit of a tangent, so bear with me. We host these webinars on just trying to keep the conversation going on some of these regulatory initiatives. And to your point, there's staff bulletin up on staff bulletins and guidance notes. And, you know, we heard the same rhetoric at the FINRA conference when we last saw each other in person. When we host these conversations and ask our audience, how are you tackling these requirements? We see an initial sort of response that says, hey, we're going to tackle it manually, the old fashioned way, paper or pen, right? Do you see that, you know, in your career? You worked at a fintech, you worked at private practice, you worked there. Do you see any risks residing around sort of that sort of, call it, idiosyncratic, Parham does it differently than Ryan, manual approach to kind of meeting these pre-trade requirements?
Well, I think first and foremost, process matters here. So, you know, putting on my former regulator hat, if I see a process to address the issues that Reg BI and other what we can call pre-trade obligations were designed to hit, I think that's going to be the gold standard. Now, I've worked for a gent in my career who was fond of saying it could be a painting of dogs playing poker on velvet or Michelangelo's The David. It's still art. So to your question, clearly there's some times where you need the David. Clearly there are other times where dogs playing poker will, you know, certainly fit the bill. What path you take, or, you know, if it's a path that's somewhere in between, is really a big function of your business. I can see a world where a manual process is perfectly appropriate if you're only doing a handful of transactions a year and that are subject to the requirements, in which case, you know, pulling together the thing in a very laborious manual fashion is certainly going to meet, you know, it's dogs playing poker, but it's still art. It's going to, you know, it's going to hit the requirements. Whereas if you have a, you know, a business with has a larger scale obligation where, you know, dogs playing poker over and over again is just going to suck all the air out of the room, then maybe you want something that's closer to the David. So that's why I think, you know, programs and processes that are driven by technology and that offer, you know, time savings in particular for not only the people, you know, across the table from their prospective clients, but also the compliance staff in the background, is certainly going to be an advantageous thing to have in the industry.
Man, yeah, now I'm seeing the architecture, kind of the underground. You got the Michelangelo and the Renaissance period thrown into there. Love it. So given your response, if you had to guess, how do you believe the wealth management industry as a whole will kind of change? If you could sort of travel in time 10 years from now, where do you see the industry?
Well, hopefully I'm seeing the industry from a chair on the beach or in the mountains, and I'm not doing this anymore because that's that, you know, I'm an old man. But, you know, kidding aside, technology, I think, will continue to drive things. And we're already seeing it now. I mean, 5 years ago, maybe a little bit more, you know, if you worked from home and you were on a phone call, you weren't, you know, there was no video, and you made every effort to keep the background noise in the background. If there was a dog barking, you quickly, you know, put your phone on mute and pretend like it never happened. Now, I mean, it's a doomed paradigm. Now, obviously, you know, what happened in the world certainly changed things or accelerated things. But nonetheless, you know, I've got two teenage sons. They haven't known a world where there hasn't been video conferencing and, you know, things on mobile. I mean, it's like many kids, they live on mobile. So I think those tenants are going to play itself out in our business quite a bit. I mean, it's even more so. We see the rise of robo-advisors, which make, you know, more sophisticated analysis tools more accessible to portfolios of smaller sizes. You know, the staff now is taking a look at, you know, more closely at the, you know, broker-dealers' use of artificial intelligence. So I think that's going to continue to drive the conversation. And I think the successful advisors will be the ones that are best able to, you know, adapt to technology, but at the same time offering that, you know, personal service, because at the end of the day, it's a service business. I'm in a service business. You're in a service business. My clients are in a service business. And the more they can provide that, you know, high touch, you know, excellent service, technology notwithstanding, and in fact, technology being an asset to it, the better off everyone's going to be.
Love it, man. I couldn't agree with you more. Technology is a lever, but that human-centric service element, I don't think will go anywhere. It's just the backbone of the technology will kind of, I think, push that further. Okay, I'm really looking forward to your response here, not only because you had Friends references and he's brought in the Renaissance, but if Ryan Smith had a magic wand Looking at it from your lens of having worked at, you know, from different perspectives, different sort of paths in the industry, what would you do to sort of improve our industry for the better?
Well, the first thing I would do if I had a magic wand is I'd wait for the next Powerball to get to 9 digits and then certainly dial up those winning numbers. So, and then, you know, you and I can have that that cocktail somewhere and talk about that Maple Leafs cap trade. But to your question, I think certainly I would make financial literacy more prominent in our society. Too many times I've seen, not only, you know, as a litigator, as a regulator, you know, dealing with situations that no one really wanted to occur, I saw a lack of, or at least a deficiency in financial literacy, or, you know, phrased a little bit more colloquially, you know, the ability to say, well, gee, does this make sense, lurking in the background. And I'm not talking about the end client, the end investor, but also sometimes you'd see it with respect to those who are on the other side of the desk. So I'd certainly make that, you know, more part of our lexicon. I don't think we do, as you know, in our society here in the States, a good job of talking about these sort of issues. We don't, you know, it's not necessarily a core part of our curriculum in school. There's organizations out there, by the way, do a fantastic job trying to fill that need. Junior Achievement, Jumpstart in particular, I volunteered for both of them. I think they do a fantastic job, but the fact that they have to fill a gap that exists is, I think, quite frankly, something we should address more broadly. So I would certainly make that more prominent part of our lifestyle. Now, and that's not to suggest that you and me and everybody else should be the next Warren Buffett or Charlie Munger. No, I mean, not in the least, but certainly having the ability to say, does this make sense? And then it gets back to the information asymmetries I was talking about with respect to why, you know, why I think there's a reg BI. I think it's going to make it, the rising tide will lift all boats.
Brian, thank you for your thoughtful responses. I mean, I didn't know about your background in architecture, and learned a bunch there, and then you threw in the Friends analogy and the Renaissance, and now with this thoughtful response. By the way, we're both Junior Achievement volunteers, so
there you go.
Plenty in common. Thank you for making time. Thank you for sharing your thoughts. Hopefully we have you back on the show fairly soon.
Thank you for having me. Wish everyone well, and thank you so much for InvestorCOM for doing this, these pieces. I mean, it's good to have this information out there, and I hope people find some value in it.
All right. Hope you enjoyed my conversation with Ryan Smith today. If please like this video and subscribe to InvestorCOM's YouTube and podcast channels for more episodes.